Oh, it's fast. Go away.
Yeah, everybody hurts sometimes, I know that's what they say. But right now it seems this loneliness won't go away, yeah. Can anybody feel this heartache? Is anyone around? Feels like we're running around in circles, we can't catch a breath. We can't enjoy the moment when we always want what's next, yeah. Just when I can't take no more, it's when I hear you say, don't hang your head when you get lonely.
His holy name, sing like me.
Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, and the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated for the liturgy of the Lord.
Prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without pain and without cost, drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully, listen, that you might have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm. The hand of the Lord feeds us, he answers all our needs. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. The Lord is good to all and compassionate toward all his works. The hand of the Lord feeds us and answers all our needs. The eyes of all look hopefully to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The hand of the Lord feeds us and answers all our needs. The Lord is just in all his ways and holy in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him. To all who call upon him in truth. The hand of the Lord feeds us. He answers all our needs.
Our second reading is a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, what will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword? No, in all of these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Actually, I can have you be seated.
Thank you.
with you.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
One does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus heard of the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew in a boat to a deserted place by himself. The crowds heard of this and followed him on foot from their towns. When he disembarked and saw the vast crowd, his heart was moved with pity for them, and he cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples approached him and said, "This is a deserted place, and it is already late. Dismiss the crowd so that they can go to the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "There is no need for them to go away. Give them some food yourselves." But they said to him, "Five loaves and two fish are all we have here." Then he said, "Bring them here to me." And he ordered the crowds to sit on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven, he said the blessing, broke the loaves, and gave them to the disciples, who in turn gave them to the crowds. They all ate and were satisfied, and they picked up the fragments left over, 12 wicker baskets full. Those who ate were about 5,000 men, not counting women and children. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
You may be seated.
Let's get back here. No.
Oh, I didn't matter. Welcome to the 18th Sunday in Ordinary. I don't know why I ever get out of book anymore, because I never use it anymore. But just in case, so welcome. I know we were closed for a whole week. It's interesting saying Mass by yourself. You do, as a priest, get used to that. You do have to do that every now and then. But it's awkward when you don't have anybody in the room with you when you do it. So I like to have people around. I wanted to include part of what last week was with this week, by the way. So I'm going to do that. So if you happen to have seen on YouTube part of it already, I'm going to include part of it anyway. And it's because I like to connect the dots. The church, when it created its three cycles, it didn't do it through happenstance. And it didn't do it randomly, you know. It was to show you that Jesus came to give a message to us in this life. Its mission and his message is our mission and message today. And along the way, we came into what is known in the summertime as the Bread of Life series, or the Bread of Life discourse. He's already told us what it is to look for the kingdom, and he's telling them now, this is what the kingdom really looks like, right? He's teaching them all the good things that they're going to do in this life. And now, after he's told all the other parables of what treasure really is, the things that are worth living, after he's told them what I told you earlier, I came to set the earth on fire, and how I wished it was now, how I wished you would have passion to live. He has to now tell them how he's going to do that. And that's difficult, right? Because Jesus told them just a few weeks ago, "My yoke and my burden is light." And what did I ask you? I said, does that look light? And he's not saying that it's light. He's saying it's light comparatively. No hardship in this world is unworth it. We can overcome anything, absolutely anything. And actually, I've gone further than that. I've said, you know, your hardships are the things that you really need to use the most. It's in the worst times in your life that people will come together. It is in the hardest times in your life that you find your strength. You find out what you're made of when love is tested. But then again, he told us, love wears wounds. Right? Last week, I was saying Jesus was trying to espouse to them through all these different parables, and I had some stories that I shared with you, that he is our greatest resource. We had learned, and St. Paul actually said the same thing. He said, all things work for the greater glory of God. All things work for God's good. That means the coronavirus also works for God's good. That means whatever is happening out there will work for God's good. Now, does that mean that it's good for you? Absolutely not. Does that mean that everything that happens in this life, any hardship you take, is a good thing? No. But it means it will resolve the end. Glory will come to God no matter what the situation is. I've known people who had severe hardships, and there's no way they want to relish in those hardships. But they also don't want to forget them, because those hardships are important. I don't want you to live in your past and be trapped by it. I don't want you to live in the future and not live this life today. But I can promise you the gospel teaches that we need all of that to make it through today. Because you have skills that you've learned from the past. You have lessons that taught you not just what traditions were, but what morality really means for you. It's whatever binds us together, right? He told us that we could do it together. Sometimes we forget that, though. We think we can go it alone. A lot of times, though, the biggest message is that we don't believe that everything works for the greater glory of God. Even though he said it, even though St. Paul said it, and even though church has proven it time and time again, even after all the Crusades, church has grown. And after all this time, we can still preach hope, even in the worst times. So once upon a time, sorry for this question. Once upon a time, there was a rabbi. Rabbi is wondering from village to village. He lives during a very difficult time. He lives during the Crusades. There's two armies that he's trying to, of course, avoid to go between these cities. He's trying to avoid Crusaders who might not like him because he happens to be a rabbi. And he's avoiding others that he knows for certain wouldn't want him to survive. And he carries with him, randomly, three things. He carries a rooster. We'll say it's a chicken, because that's dinner. And then he carries a donkey. That's his transportation, you know. And he carries a lamp. He carries the things that he needs, right? And that's what we do. We carry the things in this world we think that we need. And if we lose one of those things, we think it's the end of the world, and we scream, God, why? Right? So here he is. He's going through the woods. It's getting dark. And a storm comes. And a wind blows. And it blows out his lamp. Well, the lamp is useless to him now. So he's in the dark, and he goes, I don't know where I'm at, so I guess I'm making camp tonight. So he does. He camps there in the middle of the forest, which is very dangerous. And his chicken, we're going to say chicken, is gone. It's supposed to be a rooster because it makes noise. But he needed food, and this was his source of food. And he thinks, you know what? All things work for the greater glory of God. That's fine. I still have my donkey. And the donkey wanders off and is attacked in the wilderness by wild beasts that he hears making noise at night. But he didn't hear the donkey. And that donkey was not only his only companion at that moment, but it's also his transportation. So he couldn't go any further until later on. So he has to wait until late in the morning. He wakes up in the morning to find that he was on either side of two armies that he didn't know existed, both of which would have hunted him down. And if the wind hadn't blown and blown in his life, they would have seen him. If that chicken or rooster hadn't been gone, it would have made noise in the morning too early and alerted them that he was there. And that donkey would have alerted them that very same night. And every one of those things helped him get from A to B. He didn't know that at the time, though. One of the reasons that we don't always know that, one of the reasons we don't always believe that, though, is because we're not looking directly through the lens of our true north, of Christ. We don't look at his example. We should in all things. But a lot of people to this very day, when they look at the crucifix, they say this is suffering, this is our shame that he took on. And so we don't look at it as a source of strength. But it is. On this very night, on that very night, he didn't just forgive us. He didn't just cover our sin. He called the destroyer, and he took our place. He says, here I am for them. That's what that cry was. And we think he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He's saying he's taking our place. He's saying, you have nothing to fear. He's saying, I am here to protect them. So he is our strength. Think about that for a second now. When you have good times, a lot of times you don't think of Jesus. You think, I'll come back to him when I've got a sick loved one or something. You think about it later, right? But you won't appreciate the good you have in your life if that's not your first focus, because the good in you have in your life, right, it's not forever, because this life isn't forever. The reason the good things you do have are valuable to you is because, you know, they're perpetuated, they're loved, they're things that can't die, or they're your children, and then their children, and then their children, and on and on and on, and they're memories, they're things that are eternal, because he's eternal. So they only come into focus like the blind man when we look at him. And you can't bear the hardships of this world if you don't look at him too. Because if you didn't know that everything had a divine purpose, if you didn't know that everything would have a reason, that your suffering might actually mean someone else doesn't have to suffer, that your suffering would teach you a lesson that you one day will use to save someone else, if you didn't use him as your focus, you might not understand it. But there's one thing greater that Catholics forget, and that is that he is not just a tool. He's not just our resource. He's not just our true north. Jesus Christ is our greatest resource. Once upon a time, there was a little boy. And this little boy, he liked to build things. He was very creative. And he had this beautiful sandbox. His father put him in the sandbox, and he decides he is going to create civilization in this little sandbox, right? He's got his toy soldiers, he's got his little matchbox cars. I had matchbox cars, I don't know if he had matchbox cars or not. Alright, he's got his little Legos, because he's building civilization, and he's even got this lucky red pail, because you got to have a pail, of course, because you're in a sandbox. And he converts this red pail into his castle. And while he's building everything, it's absolutely perfect. He thinks everything is right in the world, and he sees off in the distance, 2 feet away, this huge eyesore of a rock in his sandbox, in his play box. And he says, that rock has got to go. I want that rock gone. So this child, this little boy, he does everything he can to get rid of that rock, because the rock's in his way, right? So he starts using his little fingers. I don't know if you've seen little kids, they got little pudgy fingers, and they get cut easy. So as he's trying to push the rock, and he stubs his little fingers, and he's scratching them up, and he's really frustrated now, because when you work at something for a little while and it's not immediately successful, we go, why? Right? So then he starts using the other stuff, you know, because your legs are stronger. So he uses his little pudgy feet to try to kick the rock out of his way, and it's not working. That rock's not going anywhere. He stubs his toe. He's not giving up yet, though. Because we don't give up yet. We'll go once, twice, maybe three times before we do that. So he takes his greatest resource, this beautiful red palace sandbox. He's talking about his pail. And he uses it to push the rock, and it does. And he wedges it into the corner, and it does, it works. And he's trying to use it to pick up the rock, to push it over to the side so that it's gone out of his way forever, and he didn't have to think about it. And he gets it higher and higher and higher. He didn't have the strength to get it over. And the rock falls and collapses. And it ruins his little civilization that he's created. So he screams as loud as he can. Dad! Dad! Why me? Why me? What is it you always say? Why not? So his dad comes. He picks him up. He cuddles with him. He tells him he loves him. He says, everything's fine, son. Why are you crying? And he says, why me? Why me? That big bad rock hurt me. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. And he said, son, why didn't you use your greatest resource? Why didn't you use all of your tools? And he said, I did. I used my hands, Dad. I used my feet. I used everything I could see, everything right around me, everything obvious. He said, why didn't you just ask me? And that's us. We are the child. We are the little boy. We do that. We forget the greatest resource we have, the one thing that is eternal, the one thing that cannot die, the one thing that cannot fail, we don't turn to until we absolutely have to. But we didn't have to struggle at all. We never had to. And why do we do that? Why do we wait and leave him for last? The truth is because we don't think we're good enough. Some of us think, well, I'm pretty good. It's either because you go to church or you used to, or your family are good, or people know you're a good person. And so you know you're okay, but you look at the cross and you go, I'm nowhere like that. I'm not a St. Peter. Of course, you don't necessarily know his past. I'm not a St. Paul, except he had a past too. Or I'm not an Augustine. Let me tell you about his past. Or I'm not a Francis of Assisi, and I can also promise you he wasn't perfect either. And so we don't go to him until it's too late. Or we think that we're in the middle of a rut right this second, and we have to get a little better first before we can even approach the throne to even ask for help, because why would he help me? We actually say that same question, why not me? And so we don't ask for help. You ask for help because you need it. You ask for help because you want to be the help for someone else. Once upon a time, there was a beautiful palace, a beautiful kingdom. And the king returned. And the king returned because his son was about to get married to a beautiful bride. And so he invited everyone in the kingdom to this wedding feast. He said he wanted everyone to attend, and they needed to bring their finest wedding garments. Well, he had two beggars in his palace, and they had rags. They didn't have anything else. So one of them decided, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go out and go to work. I'm going to work really, really hard. I'm going to do everything, because I cannot show up there in what I'm wearing. It's not possible. It would be a disgrace. So he went out, and he worked. He offered to do odd jobs. He tried to collect coins on the street. He did what all of us would do. He said, I'm going to get myself together first. I'm going to go back to school. I'm going to start going back to church maybe, or maybe I'll just read a little bit, or I'll do this or that, or this or this or that, or whatever. Well, anyway, the day was almost over, so he took what he had. He went to the merchant, and he said, here, take all that I have. I want your finest garment, because I want to see you. I want to go to the wedding feast. And the merchant laughed at him. He said, you can't buy the finest wedding garment with pennies. And he couldn't. The other, he knew he didn't have the time. He knew he didn't have the resources to elevate himself up to do the things he needed to do alone. So he went straight to the palace. He knocked on the door, not knowing who would answer the door, not knowing who might be available. He had never seen any of them. He just wanted to see them. He'd never even asked to see them, but now he wanted to, and he knocked. Ask, seek, and knock. And the king himself opened the door, and when the king came out, he said, hello, my son. It's good to see you. And he said to him, your holiness, all that I want is a wedding garment so that I can come to your son's wedding feast. And he says, I will give you one for my son himself. You can have his and come to the feast. That's not just a story. That is the story. That is the story of the wedding feast, of the church. He came to give you what you need, because you'll never have everything you need in this life. You cannot do everything alone. You were never meant to do everything alone. You were meant to ask, seek, and knock, that the door would be opened. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. Brothers and sisters, please turn to page 10, and together let us profess our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. God's love is made visible in Christ Jesus, and the food of the Eucharist is his greatest gift of that love. Let us pray to the Lord, who feeds us and answers all of our needs. And let us pray.
For the bishops, priests, and deacons in their daily ministry of the Eucharist, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For governments and relief agencies helping to feed the starving people of our world, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For men, women, and children threatened or attacked because of their faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who produce, prepare, and serve the food we eat, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died and gone before us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
If you have any intentions you'd like to share with us or privately, please do so now.
For all the members of our church that are recovering, and for Ramon and his wife, and for our neighbor Russ, who passed away this week, for his family, may you rest in peace.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we also pray for our neighbors that we've never met, even those that we would never have called friends. We pray for their lives, we pray for their souls, and also we pray for their memory. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We continue to pray for those who struggle in this life, Lord. We pray for those who struggle with depression. We pray for those who struggle with addiction. We pray for those, Lord, who struggle most assuredly with anger, that each and every one of them see you not only is a source, but the source of hope and happiness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for those who struggle today with illness especially. We're praying continually for Ramon and for his family. We pray today for Mary and Peter Ludovici. We pray for Terry and for Lynn. We continue to pray for Jack and for Deacon Way and for Pam. I pray for myself and I pray for each and every one of you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And universally, Lord, we pray for ourselves. We pray that you guide us everywhere we go, that you become our true north in the good and in the difficult. Let us pray, Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let us pray. Most bountiful Father, grant the favors we seek as we renew the covenant and look forward to the feast of the kingdom and the celebration of this Eucharistic sacrifice as we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
Please stand. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands
for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the good of his holy church. Let us pray. Graciously sanctify these gifts, Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy. For you are the one God, living and true, existing before all ages and abiding for all of eternity, dwelling in unapproachable light. Yet you, who are alone good, the source of life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so in your presence are countless hosts of angels who serve you both day and night, and in gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. We join with them too in singing. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, and blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give you praise, Father most holy, for you were great and have fashioned all of your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him into the domain of death. For you came in mercy to give aid to all, so that those who would seek you might find you. Time and again you offered them covenants, and through the prophets you taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior, made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He shared in our human nature all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, and to the sorrowful of heart, joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the dead, he has destroyed death and restored life. And that we may live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work into the world, he might now sanctify creation to its full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may the same Holy Spirit sanctify these gifts they become for us. The holy body and holy blood of our Lord, your Son, Jesus Christ.